I just want to point this out to, this is an important piece. On a 504, the bank funds the first lien. They also fund the second lien. So it's two different pieces.
And the main reason a bank like ours will fund that interim piece for the CDC is just to expedite the loan to help out the borrower rather than having them wait for the CDC to close. And the CDC, the benches only fund like once a month. It's usually like the middle of the month, 15th or 16th, like that. So that is one of the main reasons that banks like ours will fund that interim piece.
Welcome to the Investor Financing Podcast, where we interview real estate investors and lenders so you can learn all the secrets to getting your projects funded and scale your portfolio. And now, your host, Beau Eckstein.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Investor Financing Podcast. And we are back today with a very special guest to dive deeply into SBA financing, because the last show we've gotten a lot of viewers to reach out to both Carey and I and ask questions and looking for more information on financing with SBA for owner user type properties, real estate related. And we're going to dive into the differences of 504. We're going to talk about the 7A. We're going to talk about the basics of what you need to do to make yourself ready to be financed. So what a Form 413 is, what a debt schedule is, executive summary, the importance of getting all this put together so you put yourself in the best light possible so the bank can make an underwriting decision and move the process along quickly. Because on a 504, remember, there's two components. There's the bank piece, and then there's also the CDC piece, which you need to get CDC to package the loan request up and get SBA approval. So there's two steps with the 504 versus the 7A. But if it's a fit for 504, it's usually a better program, meaning the terms are better, superior than 7A usually. So anyways, without further ado, welcome back to the show, Carey. Let's kind of dive in, and let's first start with, you know, what's required for a 504, for the initial package. I mean, when a customer calls you or they call me, walk the customer or the viewer through what the approval process looks like, what they'll need to put together.
Okay, Beau. Once again, thank you for the opportunity to be on your podcast. As you mentioned, we got quite a few replies, and thank you very much for the opportunity. Just to touch upon what you said earlier, usually the decision to go with the 504 is sometimes loan size as well, because, you know, 7A is capped at 5 million, and then a 504 can go up to 10, 12, even beyond that, 10, 12 million. Even with the green program, you can go as high as 15 or 16 million. So sometimes it's the loan size that determines whether a borrower should go 7A or 504. But to answer your question, once I receive a loan scenario, like say you send a loan scenario in, or I have a client call, I'll put together a checklist of the core items that are needed to get it submitted to underwriting. And that includes, on the personal side, 3 years of tax returns, a personal financial statement, or the 413, as you mentioned earlier, and then a resume. And that's usually all we need initially on the personal side. On the business side, we'll request 3 years tax returns, interim statements. Like right now we're in July, so we would like to see through June, but I know it's only July 7th. And then some lenders will have a questionnaire. I have a questionnaire I send as well, just some basic questions to ask about their credit, about it, if they've ever defaulted on a government loan, because that's important questions. Because later on, underwriting does a background check, but it's good to know that information up front. But that's kind of the core package we need. And then each situation is different. If I feel underwriting might benefit with some other additional information, I'll request that as well.
Got it. And so it's interesting. We had spoken on the phone yesterday, and literally right as we got off the phone, I had a potential customer client call for a 504. He had seen one of our videos. And he's a restaurant owner, which is a difficult business to finance right now with SBA. But anyways, he's running a very successful restaurant, and he has, they've been in business since 2006. Two and a half, 3 years ago, they leased out another space with the plans of opening another restaurant. And they've essentially been using it as a kind of a staging, you know, where they're keeping all their extra supplies and things. And then they were about to get the ball rolling, then COVID hit. So they decided to wait. Now that things are opening back up, they're ready to expand to the second location. So the interesting thing is they've been leasing this second space, but now the seller wants to sell the property. So all of a sudden it's like they have to make a quick move to try to negotiate a deal and buy the property. So they're on paper, you know, they're this business is profitable. Tax returns are good. I haven't seen the full package yet, but I'm kind of diving in with the questions here because so for underwriting purposes, for a business expansion, like this is something that you see a lot in 504 where they might lease and now they want to own. So we have solid projections where we can show that the cash flow is there for their existing business. Now they're with the other operational cost of the second location. How will we look at the pro forma, you know, upon stabilization of this new restaurant being opened? Because the debt coverage, debt service coverage might not cover, right? Like it's going to be a somewhat of a pro forma based underwrite to a certain degree. How do the underwriters look at something like that from an underwriting standpoint for like a debt service coverage? Are they going to take into account the pro forma based on the new location because it's an expansion? Or do they need the cash flow from the existing business to already support this second location?
Well, the scenario you just described is by far the best as far as a restaurant loan goes, because if a restaurant is a startup, it's going to be very difficult to finance it. But if it's a second location, it's a much stronger deal. In fact, I have one in my pipeline right now. It's not a second location, but they've been in business since 2005 and they're profitable. They want to buy their building. But in this scenario, the first question that I would ask, and I'm sure you asked this as well, is the second location going to have the same name, the same menu as the first location, or is it going to be like a different concept? If it's the same menu and the same name and it's a familiar brand, then the projections would be snapped because you can kind of mirror the first restaurant. But it gets a little bit more difficult if they're going to change the concept and have a different restaurant. But knowing that the owner is successful in their first location, underwriting would definitely take that into account and analyze the projections. And we would need what's called good assumptions on those projections as well, explaining how they expect to reach that certain income level and exemption on their expenses, like taxes, payroll, everything like that.
So, that makes sense. And yes. I think the moral of the story here is that really what we're looking to do as we're putting together a package and you're working up your credit memo, and a credit memo is something that the banker, like Carey, would do once he gets the package together. He puts together a credit memo, which goes to the loan committee or the underwriting team. But really, our job is to paint the picture, right? Because
correct,
you got to remember, these underwriters, they don't know anything about you or your project, and we have to convey that in a story. And that's another thing that we should discuss is an executive summary. There's some templates out there that you can follow, but it's highly advisable, especially if it's specifically if it's a startup business, right? Like where even if they're acquiring an existing business, what are you going to, you got to tell the story. And that's what the executive summary does, who the key players are, what the story is going to be to either, you know, maintain the business, grow the business, because you're a new operator buying this business. So they want to know that you have sufficient skills to maintain and grow this business. And I think that's important because a lot of people, they'll call and they want answers right away, but you got to remember, we have to paint the picture before we can get an underwriting decision. So the more work we do up front to get to the underwriter, the more efficiently they're going to underwrite the file. So the more complete package we can do in the beginning and get all these items identified, then they're not going to come back with as many questions, right? We want to limit the amount of questions needed by answering them in this executive summary with the supporting documents. And the supporting documents are the financial statement, the tax returns, the bank statements, the personal tax returns. We have to be able to tell that story, because anything in life, if you've even refinanced your property, you understand it's, there's a lot of steps to this. And SBA is, you know, two or three times more challenging than a residential loan, maybe five times more challenging. So getting the information up front makes the process so much easier. So we want to, that's kind of the purpose of this show today, is really kind of dive into, you know, what we're looking for, things that you should be aware of that will make your life's a lot easier when you're getting ready to purchase the property that you're leasing right now, or start a new business, or so forth. Carey really focuses on real estate related SBA financing. There's a whole nother division that does business acquisition, 7A financing. But today we're really going to kind of talk mostly about real estate related SBA financing. There's some things like, if you're going to be occupying the property, you need to occupy 51% of the space. Things like that are very important to know up front, because it might be disqualified. And also, it can't be an investor type of business, meaning that you have to be the operator of this business. Doesn't mean you can't have a manager in place and things like that, but you have to be a true operator, because SBA is here to grow small businesses, not investors. So that's the other thing to kind of take the takeaway. So, you know, you can finance, if you're an attorney and you want to buy a building, a dentist, you know, there's just 100 different businesses that are eligible. I mean, there's unlimited businesses really, but it's got to have that owner user component to it to be eligible. So hotels, self-storage, owner user type industrial businesses. What are some other kind of businesses that you funded? Probably some cold storage facilities if they're an owner user. Pretty much anything that's an owner user type business can be financed, unless it's, there's a few prohibited businesses.
And Beau, getting back to what you mentioned a few moments ago, I would say in a majority of the cases, like say you mentioned a lawyer or a doctor or a veterinarian or an attorney buying a building, in most cases, their mortgage payment is lower than what they're currently paying for rent, and plus they're building up equity. So I mean, that's a huge place. That's a huge benefit of what we call rent replacement deals.
Rent, yeah. But,
and our bank, we do a lot of we love manufacturing deals, you know, light manufacturing deals, self storage, as you mentioned. We stay away from hotels and gas stations only because of the risk factor involved. We've had some previous defaults. But beyond that, any owner user property with real estate, we will consider and take a look at.
Got it. So let's kind of go back. So there's an initial conversation, either Carey or myself's having this with the potential borrower. There's a needs list, the form 413, which is a personal financial statement. That's a specific form for SBA. A debt schedule, you want to show the existing debts of the business. And that's just a simple template. If you don't have a resume, we do have templates that can help you fill out your resume. They do want resumes on anybody that's going to be a signer for the loan. And what that means, a signer would be anybody that has 20% ownership or greater. So sometimes there's some smaller partners in the deal that own less than 20%. They don't necessarily need to go onto the loan. Sometimes underwriters will, if it looks like more of an investor deal, they will, from my understanding, like if they have four partners that each have 18%, or two partners that have 12%, and they don't like to see that kind of thing, right? Because they think that when they're looking at those type of deals, that they're trying to kind of work the system. So you got to be, when you're setting this up, you got to know the players and so forth, right? Like if you had a couple people with that had less ownership, it looks more like an investment type deal versus the people that are on the loan application have the ownership, and maybe there's one other partner with less, and they're more of an equity or a silent partner per se.
And the SBA does allow that, but in each scenario is different. But if, and sometimes it's a lender call. Sometimes if somebody is a big investor and they have some kind of control as far as decisions go with the business, then the lender will ask that person to be a guarantor. But if the majority holder who does not put a large investment in, he will definitely be a guarantor and who makes the management decisions. But every deal is case by case, but some people do try to manipulate the system and have somebody who would put 100% of the down payment in. And lenders always want to see skin in the game from the main operator, the person who has the day-to-day control over business decisions.
But you can potentially get your 10% or 15% as a gift from family?
Yes. And then that's also, I mean, some lenders will allow 100% of the down payment to be a gift. Our bank, our CFO likes to see skin in the game. Normally the general rules half gift and then half from the borrower. But that's also true with seller carries too. If there's a seller carry situation, I like to see half and half. But a gift has more strength though, because it doesn't have to be paid back, and the donor signs an affidavit to that effect.
Got it. So let's just kind of dive into a 504. I mean, based on, I know it's lender discretion, but SBA guidelines, will they allow for a seller credit? I mean, let's take the bank out and just talk strict 504. Hypothetically, could somebody get a 10 or 15% seller carryback from the seller as their down payment? Or is that an overlay specific to the banks?
It's like you said, it's a bank decision, and it can be 100% seller carry, but there's risk involved. And another unique thing is that a seller carry is different for a 504 than it is for a 7A. On a 504, the 504 SBA guidelines allow the seller to be paid back from day one, interest only in most cases. On a 7A, that seller carry has to be on standby for the entire length of the loan, meaning the seller can't receive any payments at all. So the seller carry is a little bit more flexible on a 504. And some lenders will allow the entire down payment to be in the form of a seller carry.
Yeah. I mean, that's definitely more high risk, and that's why a lot of banks do not want to do that.
Correct.
Right. Because anything that doesn't have any skin in the game, the borrower is more likely to walk away because
that is so true.
But SBA, remember, you are signing personal guarantees. Mm-hmm. Now let's kind of walk into when and why 7A versus 504. This is such a common question, and I've been getting a lot of calls, and it's like I listen to the story of what they're trying to do, and I'm thinking in my head, okay, is it too small really for a 504? It's a $400,000 or $500,000 deal. There's not many banks that are going to do small 504s like that. It's just that, you know, usually makes sense to do 7A. But really, when it comes down to it, I think there's some reasons why, like for example, on a 7A, they're always going to look for additional collateral. So they're always going to look to put a lien on your primary residence or some of your rental properties that you do own. And that's like standard, right, Carey? I mean, that's mm-hmm. protocol. So that's a reason why a 504 would be superior, because you probably want to have flexibility of being able to use the equity in your primary house to do other things with. And so you could be limited if you have a second lien on the property, right? Exactly. So that's something you need to be aware of, why you might not want to use a 7A. Why you might want to use a 7A is because you can finance not only the real estate, but the intangibles, the business, right? So let's just say they're buying the building for $1 million and then they're buying the business for 250. You could only, on a 504, you can only finance the $1 million, right? Because that's the only thing financeable, that and the mortgage costs and so forth. But with 7A, you can finance the intangibles in the business. So you could be doing potentially 90% of total project costs. So that's sometimes why you might want to do a 7A. But if you look at it from a cost perspective, not many lenders that I see out there are doing anything fixed rate with SBA. There's a few. Carey's got a 7A product that will potentially do a fixed rate for 5 years or so. But the majority of SBA lenders I see, they're Wall Street Journal prime rate plus the margin, right? And it's a floating rate that changes monthly. And that is somewhere, I don't know, 5.75, 6%, 6.25, right? Depending on the margin for a lot of banks that I'm seeing pricing on business acquisition stuff. I think the pricing does get a little bit better if it's real estate backed. Is that kind of accurate, Carey, what you see in the market?
It is. Okay. It is. And we're one of the few banks that, like you said, Bill, that offers a 5-year fixed, and it repeats every 5 years fixed, depending what the prime is. So technically it's a fixed rate the whole 25-year term, but it resets every 5 years.
Do you know if SBA is going to get, banks, I mean, let's just put it this way. SBA, we always kind of mix this up, but SBA does not make the loans. They guarantee. So when Carey's bank makes a loan, they're getting a portion of that guaranteed by the SBA. And that's changed over the last couple of years, right? I think the guarantee went up because they're encouraging banks to make more loans right now.
The guarantee on a 7A went up to 90%, but that's only through the end of September. It's more of an incentive. It's more of a CARES Act, a COVID a benefit or adjustment, if you will.
Right. And I would say they're doing that to stimulate the economy. They're promoting business growth because banks are more inclined to lend when they're getting a bigger guarantee. There's less risk. If they do their job correctly, meaning underwrite the file and do all their due diligence, then it's on the, it would be on the guarantee, not them. I mean, if they don't underwrite properly, then they're on the hook still, essentially.
Yes.
So that's important to know. So if you look at the SBA volume collectively, I think we're at historic levels of funding. I mean, not just the PPP and everything, but I'm just saying 7A and 504s are the hottest product out there in lending right now.
I saw I'm sure a lot of the folks watching subscribe to the Coleman Report. It's a daily podcast or daily SBA podcast that they have, and they showed the numbers through three quarters, which fiscal year ends, I think, at the end of September. But 504s have already surpassed last year for the whole year, the 504 fundings. And I can't remember about 7As. I just looked at 504s, but that's phenomenal that we've already passed the whole year of production from last fiscal year up through three quarters this year.
Have you ever done a 504 with a companion 7A or?
Yes.
Okay.
So. Pretty much because with 504s, working capital is not an eligible loan proceed outlay. So we'll do a small 7A for working capital or for inventory, whatever. It's called a piggyback loan.
Yeah. We call it piggyback, or some people call it companion. So that's really cool, guys. Like, this is something a lot of people don't know about. That you can do a 504 with a piggyback or a companion 7A to get the proceeds you need. So on some deals that make sense, we can structure like that, which that means to you, that means higher loan proceeds, which means you're funding more of the acquisition and the business itself. So you can fund working capital potentially. When you're doing a 7A like that, let's just say they needed $500,000 in working capital. Do you, the 7A companion, potentially if it meets cash flow or debt coverage requirements, meaning there's plenty of coverage coming in, you can, with a 7A, you can fund 80 or 85-90% of the piggyback of the working capital and inventory potentially?
Yes, but if all the funds are strictly for working capital, we would, and this is true with all lenders, we would want a breakout of how those funds will be spent. You know, whether they're going to use it for marketing or payroll or whatever, we would want a breakout of how the funds will be spent.
So you can also do that for the intangibles too. So yes. Meaning, so you could potentially fund that with, so you fund the business, the real estate with the 504, and then the companion or the piggyback 7A funds the business acquisition component of it. So that's a very useful tool for people to know. So we talked about gift, we talked about potential seller carry. And so now let's just talk about the process in general. So you've got, okay, you had your initial talk with me, with Carey. We kind of sized up the project, the deal itself. You get your initial needs list. You get all those items in. It then gets it gets packaged up. A credit memo is prepared. The file is sent to the credit committee or the underwriter. They review the file. And then usually, depending on how busy, and most people, most banks and non-bank SBA lenders are extremely busy, it's going to take anywhere from 7 to 12 days to get an indicative term sheet, where they'll give you a term sheet with, you know, what to expect as far as loan proceeds, rates, fees, that kind of thing. From that standpoint, from then on the SBA side, I mean, even prior to that, what a good originator will do is they're going to already queue you up, the borrower, with a good CDC. Because remember, on a 504, you got to work together with the CDC. So the CDC needs to get engaged. At what point do you like to get the CDC engaged, Carey, in the deal itself?
You're listening to the Investor Financing Podcast. We'll be right back after this break.
Are you in the market for a commercial loan? Did you find the perfect opportunity but need funding? Have a special situation? At Find the Bank, you will get quotes with competitive rates and terms from multiple lenders without any hassles. Have a multifamily property, construction project, owner-user property, industrial, mixed use, hotel? At Find the Bank, you can get nearly any kind of commercial financing. The process is simple. Once you send us some information about you and your property, we send back a quote sheet. Then we quickly connect you with an advisor. You won't spend hours calling multiple banks, trying to find the right person to talk to. We'll connect you fast to the right person, hassle-free. Better terms than you could get on your own. Go to findthebank.com and complete the form. An advisor will be connected with you within minutes to discuss your specific financing needs.
Right at the very start, but if it's kind of a high risk deal, our bank wants to wait till we have internal approval before we engage the CDC.
If you're a direct preferred SBA lender, you can underwrite the deal and prove it, and you never have to get SBA's sign off, essentially, versus the 504, you do need to sign off. But that needs to be orchestrated, and sometimes on some marginal deals that are more challenging, it's important to get the blessing from the CDC, because that encourages the banks to make the loans as well, saying, oh, it's already been sized up by the CDC and they feel very confident. That would then maybe give Carey and his team like, wow, okay, they're on board. So I had that happen previously. That's why I know that I was able to get a non-bank SBA excited about a project, because it's already been sized up from the CDC standpoint. So I think there's kind of a different philosophy around that for some deals versus other deals. So we engaged the CDC at in the beginning, or at some point, you know, in the first couple of days or week or so. The CDC is basically going to need almost like a replicated package of what the bank needs. So we gather those documents for the CDC. the CDC has a loan officer there too, or account, business development. They're not necessarily a loan officer. I don't know what you want to call them. Usually like a vice president or business development. They help package up the deal on their end. And then once they have everything on their end, they then ship it to SBA. And the time they send it off to SBA, it's varies. Right now they're extremely busy, but maybe it's a 4-week timeline for an underwriting decision. Is that what you're seeing, Carey?
Yes. And some CDCs, Beau, are fast and can turn a file around in less than a week. Others take 2 to 3 weeks. It just depends how busy they are. And back when things were normal pre-COVID, it seems like a majority of them they only take them a week to do it to review, underwrite, and approve the deal internally. But now it's like I said, it's taken some CDCs like 3 weeks. And then, unfortunately, with SBA, the file has to be approved by SBA before the first lien lender can close. And that process is now taking 26 business days. That should really go way down after September, the end of September, because that's when all the incentives will stop. And then, and once again, pre-COVID, SBA approval took like 2 or 3 days, but now it's taking 26 business days. So everybody has jumped on the 504 bandwagon this year because banks have cut way back on their conventional lending and that's what's, and that combined with the incentives from the CARES Act, there's just such a backlog in the SBA right now. But that still shouldn't discourage anybody from pursuing a 504 because the rates are, blended rates right now are still at 3.8%. The CDC current rate right now is 2.9%. And then like our bank, we're 4.25%. So that blended rate is 3.8%. And that's one of the biggest benefits of a 504 is just that long-term fixed rate at a low rate.
Yeah, and I think that's really the number one. I mean, if you're looking at lowest cost, highest leverage capital out there for these type of properties, businesses, you can't beat the 504 as far as cost of capital. And that's where you save. And that's why if you're looking at a 7A versus a 504, the 504 from that perspective is always going to win, at least in the next couple of years. I don't see a 7A having the same pricing strategy, because remember, most of them are variable rate. So, rates are probably not going to go down over the next couple of years. They're probably going to go up. So I just want to point this out to, this is an important piece. On a 504, the bank funds the first lien. They also fund the second lien. So it's two different pieces. And then if it's a construction deal, when there's a certificate of occupancy, or if it's just a stabilized deal, there's still an interim piece, meaning that the CDC has not actually acquired the second lien yet. And that takes 30 to 90 days. So there's always an interim fee in the transactions, whether it's a construction or a stabilized acquisition. There's always an interim piece before the debenture. So that's important to know. So on construction, you have, and typically 50% of the loan proceeds is a senior debt, is senior lien. And then 30 to 35% is the SBA piece of total, right, cost. And so during a construction loan, it's also important to know, because some banks don't actually fund the interim piece and they outsource that to like these different construction, they're kind of like interim bridge lenders. So some banks fund all of it, like Carey's bank, if they were doing a construction project, for example, would fund the senior and the junior piece. But there's actually banks that only would fund the senior piece and they rely on like a third party company that funds these interim construction loans. So it's very interesting. And then once there's certificate of occupancy, the debenture happens. And that's when, correct me if I'm wrong anywhere, Carey. And that's when the loan is purchased. So there is always an interim piece, whether it's a construction or stabilized. Is there anything I said wrong or you could add in on that?
No, the main reason a bank like ours will fund that interim piece for the CDC is just to expedite the loan to help out the borrower rather than having them wait for the CDC to close. And the CDC, the debentures only fund like once a month. It's usually like the middle of the month, 15th or 16th, like that. So that is one of the main reasons that banks like ours will fund that interim piece. And you mentioned these third party lenders that also, if a bank does not fund the interim loan, those type of lenders are out there, but normally they charge a lot of fees and their interest rates are pretty high. But if that's the only option that a borrower has, I mean, that they have to go for it. So it's best to search out a bank like ours where it funds the whole loan, the permanent loan and the interim loan.
Yeah, the cost of capital is far superior, but in some circumstances, it's more of a high risk deal per se. And so, and some banks might just be particular, not fund this secondary piece. So that's why you would pay extra cost to get something done. And it does happen. I see it often because they'll do more aggressive construction deals. Like you'll see that a lot in hospitality, for example, especially right now. And you got to remember, every bank, every non-bank, every SBA lender, although they have guidelines and underwriting guidelines from SBA, they also have their own guidelines. And so some lenders prefer certain asset classes. Some lenders just focus on non-real estate SBA. Some of them have their, right? Everybody has a sweet spot and not many banks are generalists. Usually they have a certain appetite. So that's where I come in, is that I have contacts like Carey. I have other contacts, like if it's not a good fit, I have to figure out where to bring the transaction to. And the great thing about Carey, he's been a very good resource because he's been around the SBA industry for a long time. He's got a lot of contacts. What I like about this is that everybody is kind of, everybody shares information in this space, which is good because at the end of the day, we're trying to help people, you know, grow their wealth by owning their own business, by owning their own real estate. And I think it's an optimum time to do rent replacement right now, dentists and attorneys and so forth. Is there any kind of special programs for these type of medical professionals within the SBA? Or is it just the standard SBA program?
It's just that there's no particular benefits for professionals like that. It's just the same as everything else.
What is anything with veterans or things like that? Are there any specialty programs for veterans?
There used to be. I think they've done away with some of the veteran benefits that both 7A and 504s used to have, which is not a good thing. But yeah. And I'm going to be totally honest. If there's any kind of benefit that's in place right now, I don't know about that. I know 3 or 4 years ago, there's some benefits for being a veteran, but I don't think they exist now, unfortunately.
So on a SBA loan, is there a difference on the incentives for the 7A versus the 504 right now? Can you kind of briefly talk about the incentives that are, I believe it's this incentive package is expiring September 26th or 7th or something?
Yes. And the big difference is a 504 loan just has to be approved by the end of September, but a 7A loan has to close and be funded by the end of September. And that's a little under 90 days until that point. So a 7A could easily be submitted this month and still receive those benefits. A little bit more difficult with a 504 because we got the delays with SBA, but it still can happen. Let's say if by the 15th of this month, if a 504 would be submitted, that it could still meet the deadline. Of course, there's a lot of factors involved, as you know, Beau. The borrower has to be responsive. The unfortunate thing about the 504 loan, if CDC sends a file to them and it's called a screen out, if they find something they need, they have more questions, like it comes back to the CDC into the bank. And then once those questions are answered, it goes back to the bottom of the pile again. So if there's a screen out, there's no way that particular loan will receive the benefits. But I'm a pro 504 guy, but at this point right now, 7A is probably for smaller loans a better option, because if you're a PLP lender, it's going to be approved and be closed by the bank. And there's not that delay like the 504s have with SBA.
Yeah, and that's another reason why sometimes you want to go with 7A, because it's all done in-house with a PLP, meaning they have full authority to close the loan without any other secondary approvals. And that's another reason, timing. If it's a quick deal, 7A sometimes has to be a 7A. On a 504, the advantage is, additionally, is if you do 504 green, collectively you can have 16.5 million of combined SBA loans versus just 5 million with a standard standard SBA. Now, all these people that have gotten PPP and EDIL, are we counting that against their 5 million cap?
No.
Okay.
Because the PPP loans, for the most part, will be forgiven. The EIDL loans, that's a good question on the EIDL loans. I know PPPs don't count against the cap, but EIDL loans may. And so I mean, to be honest, once again, being honest, I don't know. I mean, I can find that out with a quick phone call to our 7A group at the bank.
Yeah, that's just a question I would wonder, because there's people that have 500 or 1,000 or so. So you could essentially, on 7A 504, you could have three or four different SBAs open. Like if you are owner operator of two different type of businesses, like I had a self-storage business that I ran in town, and I wanted to go buy another business that I was going to operate. If it's two different businesses, guidelines, are they still okay with that? If you had experience in those kind of realms and you qualified other than that and the debt coverage was good.
Yes.
You could have multiple SBA. I could have a $500,000. Like if I bought a business, for example, and I did a business acquisition with a 7A, and then I wanted to go buy a building for another business I had, and I was going to occupy that space, I could have collectively $5 million. But strategically, knowing that I could do the green, maybe I do the LID. If I'm building self-storage and I'm going to, you know, build five locations, if you're strategic about it and you can put in some green elements to that, you might want to look at doing the green program, because that's going to help you.
Absolutely. And with the green loan program, you could have, it used to be unlimited, but now they've, because a lot of hotel deals were just, were infinite, but now they've reduced to three green projects up to $5.5 million each. But collectively, that's over $40 million in purchasing power that you have with those three green loans.
Yeah, it's phenomenal. And a lot of people don't know this. So that's the reason why we're doing this show, is like, there's lots of options out there. And and there's really specialty lenders out there too. Like some lenders they really love healthcare type assets. And so that's what I've really set out to do, is figure out who's the best of the best for different type of assets, because it makes the underwriting process easier. Like if I know what Carey likes, I can bring Carey. You have a pretty good appetite. Carey likes to look at deals and he's going to underwrite it quickly. He wants to do as many deals as he can. You know, he's got to work and try to beat up the underwriter to get them to sign off on the deal, because every bank's got some sort of credit committee and underwriting process. But Carey's kind of like, you know, he sees it. He's going to know, you know, based on SBA guidelines, is this an eligible type of deal? And then he's going to want to do it if it's something that the bank can do. And he's going to size it up and put it through and get a quick underwriting decision and give you valuable feedback. So that's important, right? Because if you just go to one person or one bank, I have a lot of people that go to like their local bank, for example, and they don't get the best advice sometimes. Like, oh, well, 504 is not good for you, I'm going to do the 7A. And so they oftentimes steer their clients away from 504s. And from my understanding, banks make more money on 7A's. So it could be a reason why they're easier, they make more money. So that's probably why a lot of banks always push 7A versus 504s. But Carey's main focus, the point is Carey's main focus is 504. All he wants to do is 504s. He can do 7As, but his focus and his business. So he's a guy you're going to get good information from. So I think circling back is that if you just go to one bank, you're only going to get what their little bank gives you, right? And you're either going to fit or not. So the point is you should get good advice from the start, and then it's going to help the process, whether I help you, Carey helps you, or we just have a conversation and you get some information and maybe it's not a good fit for either of us. But that's really how I think you're going to find the best financing for your particular situation, because everybody has a different situation. So that's kind of my two cents on the lending world.
No, and Bo, I agree 100%. And I see it all the time where somebody would go to their local bank because that's where they have their accounts and everything. And a lot of local banks don't have a dedicated SBA department. And you are correct. If a bank sells a 7A loan on the secondary market, they're going to make the premiums are still pretty good right now. And some banks will make more money on a 7A. Our bank, we portfolio every 504 loan that we do. So we keep them on the books and, you know, we earn the interest on them and everything. So, I mean, a lot of banks, there's a secondary market for 504 as well. Not as strong as 7A, but a bank like ours, we just keep them on the books.
So that means those other banks, really, their incentive is churning. The more volume they do, the more money they make and so forth. So, yeah, it's interesting just to learn the mechanics of how banks work, right? Because I borrow money all the time from lending institutions. So somebody who's listening, I hope you're getting a lot of value out of this conversation, because there's a lot of nuggets here where, you know, how you can make yourself look better as a borrower, steps to do, action steps. I mean, you might not be SBA ready right now. Maybe your tax returns, maybe you haven't shown, you know, you've had a business for 3 years and your tax returns are not showing what they need to show. Any advice on somebody who might be, you know, they have good credit, but their business, they're getting ready to try to expand, but their cash flow might not be there. I mean, they got to just basically hunker down and know that they either need to put a very good plan together of why now they're going to start seeing growth after 3 or 4 years. Do you get those kind of situations too, where now they've had kind of marginal returns? I mean, they're profitable, but now they're trying to do a bigger kind of expansion. I mean, how do you get those type of deals approved? Like, what's the shot to get those approved?
Well, in that case or that scenario you just described, a borrower may want to seriously consider hiring a professional to write a business plan for them. And I got a couple of contacts that I've established a relationship with through the years, and they do a great job. Because, I mean, as you know, there's different levels of your basic executive summary, maybe one or two pages, but a business plan, short of a feasibility study, will have a lot of information in it and give a lender a comfort level. Since a professional prepared it, it's always better to have a professional in that industry prepare your business plan for you. So that's probably one strong thing that a borrower could do to achieve success on a loan approval.
Oh, I think that's huge, right? Because, I mean, when you really think about it, this is your business, and if you get a little dinky executive summary, you know, it's understandable, but really underwriters are looking at that, credit committee's looking at that, like, versus this really detailed professional story with professional, you know, pro forma built in and things like that. So is it worth you to spend a couple grand so you can actually maybe even get more proceeds, right? The more detailed this is, and you're really stressing how the growth's going to happen and where it's happening, and it's identified in this, you know, I'm sure that's helped numerous people get a lot more in loan proceeds because they were super detailed and they told the story correctly. So I would agree 100% that's, you know, like, I'm looking eventually to buy some cash flow businesses that I can own and operate, right? So like, knowing all this stuff is going to help me. And that's why we're doing this show, is is to hopefully help everybody out there that's looking to acquire a business or, you know, move their chiropractic business into their own space and own the building or whatever, do some kind of rent replacement to create more wealth for their business. And not to mention, when you own the property, you also can take advantage of not only the appreciation, the mortgage pay down, and then also the depreciation of the property. So that's also a huge incentive for owning the property. And now with rates at historic lows and you know, with property values, you know, over the next 10 or 20 years, they're probably going to be worth more than they are today. We might have some slower times in between, but historically real estate always appreciates over the years. So it's always a good time. And I think it'll be interesting. I do think that SBA will maintain some kind of be aggressive over the next few years to keep the economy stimulated, because if there's any kind of recession or any kind of downturn in the economy, that's the one driver is the SBA can drive the economy by supporting local small businesses. And that's really what they're here for, is to help small businesses. And that's, small businesses are defined as less than 500 employees, I believe. And it
depends on the industry.
Yeah. So there's certain guidelines for each industry, certain revenue guidelines, and certain net worth requirements. Like if you're a super whale and your true net worth is over $15 million or so, it's hard. But most people, when they send a financial statement and it says they're worth $30 million, the way it's SBA really looks at net worth is totally different. So sometimes people are like, well, am I going to have a problem? You know, qualifying because my net worth is $32 million. And really, how do they take out the real estate from the financials? Do you know how they look at the actual net worth?
It's called tangible net worth. And I think that they'll take out any goodwill in their businesses. And of course, depreciation. It's called tangible net worth.
Yeah. So a lot of people that are $30, $40 million net worth, at least they think, are really could qualify. So really you could be pretty substantial and still get SBA financing.
And usually in most cases, when you see somebody with a net worth like that, they've given a lot of value to their existing businesses as far as equity in their business. That usually makes up a majority of that net worth.
Well, that's usually how it is, right? Everybody thinks their house, when I used to sell real estate, everybody thinks their house is worth more than the neighbors, right? It's just the same thing. Everybody thinks their business is worth more than what it is. It's just it's funny because you'd go and say, okay, the next door neighbor is an identical model math to yours and it's sold for $1 million. Why do you think your house is worth $1.2 million? People just think their business or their assets are worth more because it's theirs.
And what's ironic, it's better to be conservative than it is to inflate the value of your equity in a business or whatever. So that's from an underwriting point of view. It's just better to be more conservative.
All right. Well, great. I think we touched on a lot today. We'll definitely have you back for some encore sessions. I'd like to keep these. We almost went an hour. Goes quick. Any golden nuggets you want to leave us with going forward here?
Well, regarding 504s, they're supposed to be where they make. We've got some pretty good refinance benefits right now that weren't in place before, and there's some discussion in Congress whether to make these permanent. So, and it's still being discussed. So we hope that happens, you know, before the end of the year, where these temporary 504 refinance incentives will be permanent. I mean, to give you an example, normally to refinance a 504, to use a 504 loan to refinance debt, it has to be seasoned for 2 years. Right now, that's down to 6 months. So there's benefits like that would really help the program.
So can you refinance a conventional loan into an SBA?
Yes.
And you could wrap in, like, if you had some assets too, like if you had a couple loans on some hard assets, you could essentially wrap those all into a 504 refinance potentially?
whatever is included in that 504 refinance has to be, whatever the original use of those funds were, it has to be 504 eligible. So if they want to refinance, like say the money they paid out of the business for their kids' college education, that wouldn't qualify, or they took a trip or something. It has to be business related.
So as long as it, as long as it was business related.
Yeah.
But that, so that's a, and you can also do a 504 into another 504 refi?
For expansion, currently for expansion. You can also refi a 7A into a 504 if it's for expansion.
Mm, interesting.
Yeah.
See, there's all these nuggets out there, guys, and I hope you got a lot of value out of this episode. And Carey, thank you again for coming on for the second time. And I think this one was even better than the first one. And love to keep doing this, you know, every other month or so. And we'll do a new episode on highlight what's going on with guidelines. And actually, the next one we do, I'd love to do like a couple case studies and do a PowerPoint. And we don't need the addresses or anything, any details to the exact, you know, property, location, business, but we can actually show how it was structured and different, maybe pick a couple different business types. And I think that would be really powerful to show, you know, this is what the senior debt looked like. This is the junior debt. Here was the equity injection. This is how it was structured. Here was the general terms. And we can actually just show that how that actually a couple case study deal structures. I think that'd be very valuable for people to see how these what it actually looks like.
And I do have a 504 PowerPoint presentation that is current up through the current incentives. I think I sent you a copy when you and I first started communicating, but it's an excellent PowerPoint. So maybe we can incorporate that the next time we do this.
That's very good. Well, thank you everybody for watching. Please like, subscribe. There's a calendar link below. Book a call with me if you want to talk about financing or business acquisition, anything real estate or business related, I'd love to talk to you about. And we'll put Carey's information below as well. Feel free to reach out to Carey. Probably send him an email. He actually picks up his phone too, and I don't think he minds giving out his cell phone number, but we'll give you his contact information below. And anyway, really appreciate you, Carey. Thank you so much.
And both, thank you as well. Once again, appreciate the opportunity. And let's hope that that response time with SBA goes down quickly.
Yes, agreed.